Well, you normally start by thanking the organizers to invite you here. I'm not so sure if in this case I have to thank them, because you know, it's a bit tough for me to prepare this presentation. I'm not used to talk about these issues. I'm more on the waste management, environmental taxation, and other aspects. But they, since we in the consultancy are quite active, so I will try to explain you now. In the area of research, they asked me to develop a bit the idea on how consultancies can be also actors in the research area, how can be established links with the academia and the university, and also which is the role or the possible role of public administrations in supporting research, both in consultancies and in the academia. So these are basic goals of my presentation. I will start by presenting a little bit who we are. Probably you know already a bit since we are part of the entitled project and you know some of our colleagues. I will develop then what are the types of research that can be done in a consultancy. From my presentation I will be using examples I know from our own work to exemplify this, and also, as I said, which are the options for public administration to also conduct, support, orientate this research, and then I will very briefly conclude with some general opinions on this. My idea is to talk about 30 minutes or so, and then we can start a debate. So, ENT is a rather small consultancy and research center. We are 11 people at the moment. And we have two different legal forms, a company and a foundation. And our mission, generally speaking, is contributing towards a social, environmental, and economically sustainable society by studying and implementing innovative approaches in the fields of environmental policies. We are located in Villanova de Sotú, which is around 40 kilometers in the south of Barcelona. And our main working areas are, as I said, waste management, particularly urban waste management, ecological and environmental economics. Three of the founders of this project did our PhD here in the Autonomous University of Barcelona under the supervision of Martín Ravier, so we are familiar with the discipline of ecological economics, and although this discipline is still not very present in the area of consultancy, we try to do quite a lot of work on this. Then I'm coordinating these two areas, and then Miquel Ortega is coordinating these other two, environmental justice and political ecology, and also fishing policies. So our work is mainly for public administrations, from the local to the European level, but also occasionally, but increasingly, we are also working for other actors such as NGOs, universities, or even trade unions or political parties. Very rarely we work for companies, in most cases, either public administrations or institutions with a public interest. Okay, then starting with the issue of research, in the area of consultants, it's not so common to find people also doing research. Often our colleagues feel quite surprised about us being active in the area of research, but this has been like that in our case since we started. And I will now develop this a little bit, but just wanted to inform you that we recently approved or elaborated a research plan for the next years just to try to have our own orientation and define a little bit the areas, main areas, priorities, and also resources to be allocated in the following years to this research. I include the link here, although it's only in Spanish and Catalan now, but it's in English. And this was an effort to organize, as I said, a little bit the priorities and also the resources, which are particularly scarce in our case, because of our size and because it's difficult to find sources to finance all these research projects. I also wanted to mention these two all means of publication. These two, this is a collection of books, only one issue so far, but there will be more coming along. And then this journal, which we edit every 6 months, along with Italian Editorial, and in which John Martinez is not only the founder, but also still continues to coordinate the journal. It's published in Spanish and distributed in Spain and Latin America. And every issue focuses in one specific topic, this one on cities, for example.
You're very welcome to contribute if you want, by the way.
Miquel Ortega is the main brain, coordinating and making this happen along with you, Mark, and some others. Okay. Well, how is that the consultancy can contribute, can do research, can contribute doing research? First of all, it can be in the framework of specific research projects. In this case, I will give now some examples. In this case, it is more like acting like a private research center. Okay. First of all, one first option could be getting involved in consortia, taking part in competitive calls for proposals. This can be done at different geographical levels, from the European to the regional mainly. And this calls for proposals, in the case of research programs, are often led by universities or research centers. This is for example, the case of Horizon 2020 at the European level. But as you know, the European Union or the European Commission is favoring more and more the participation of SMEs in these programs. So we normally are, or we quite often are approached by universities or research centers asking for the participation of us as a company in the consortium. One example is again entitled, the project we are now in which is led by the university, but it was seen by all parties as good to have also other type of actors in the project, like us as SME. Similar things happen at national levels. Of course, I can talk more about the case of Spain. There are several calls. One is, for example, Torres Quevedo, which is a program conceived to involve people holding a PhD to facilitate their involvement in companies, in private companies. So we were successful in one occasion with one researcher who had a PhD here from the University of Autonomous of Barcelona again. And with her, we presented a proposal on sustainable local finances, a particularly critical issue in Spain, because municipalities' economic situation was very cyclical, depending a lot on the revenue they got from new urban development and so on. So when the crisis started, they took part of the worst hit. So just as an example from this project, several publications, both in national and international journals, derived on based on the research we conducted thanks to this project. Similarly, at the regional level, we also have found some opportunities in the past, more than in the present, I have to say. This AGAUR is the Catalan research, or the Catalan department dealing with universities, and they used to have a program to facilitate also the obtention of PhDs while working in a company. So both in the case of Miquel and one other case, they were successful in getting this fellowship, so to say. And so in this case, we have two PhD theses coming out of these grants, and a number of articles that derive from that. In the case of Miguel, his PhD thesis on environmental justice, and in the case of Jaume Freire, he did his PhD thesis on the issue, on the important issue of energy efficiency and the rebound effect. And since then, he's been active publishing part of those results, and also continue to do some research on that.
If you want, just to point one more thing on that, is that sometimes we can think that these public administrations are not going to support very contentious issues, as for example, environmental justice issues in Catalonia, like MCU's, their CEO, or what happened with their ancestors. Mm. But sometimes it's a way of explaining them what you want to do. I mean, it's about evaluating public policies, for example. This is something that sounds more or less good. That's not a problem for them. And that's also, it's not only about the themes, but also how we present our themes in some specific areas. And that's the only point you can play there. My feeling is that you can do as critical issues as you want if you present them in the proper way. And this is, I mean, sometimes we manage to get through the system toward this. For example, with this, as once we had this research done, we went to the municipality of Barcelona and we asked them, okay, we want to do a specific study on environmental justice in Barcelona. And of course they say, no, that's too political. But if you say environmental equity, then it won't be all right for us. And then of course we change the title and say, okay, we are going to do research on environmental equity. That's it. So sometimes it's
that. You did that?
Yes. So it's just a way to show that sometimes things that can be just presented in a different way and do whatever you want without too many problems.
Not always like that.
Not always like that. Yeah, 100.
I was thinking I've tried maybe 1,000 times to find sources to conduct studies on environmental harmful substances, for example, and I never managed because it's quite. But more or less, sometimes it's a matter of how to present the data. One other way to collaborate or to get involved in research project is just to be subcontracted by universities. I mean, consultancies, one of the things we can provide is very practical applied knowledge. One example we are doing at present is part of the Mars project, which is a project led also by the Autonomous University of Barcelona by Mario Giampietro. Well, I think they are not the leaders, but they are partners. It's a live project, and here we are supplying them with very practical knowledge on the situation of waste management in the metropolitan area of Barcelona. They have the theoretical framework, the theoretical tools they want to apply, but they lack contacts, data. So this is the role we can also do sometimes. And then, and this is quite particular from our situation maybe, or more particular, is that research that is read from non-research projects, which means that you don't get funds to do that research, which means that you have to fund it yourself. In that case, basically, what we do is try to, from the normal consultancy projects we do, try to use their results to convert them into research products. But we have to be very efficient on that because we are not yet paid for that. So we can only do that with the surplus from other projects. And there are some other particular circumstances. For example, you have to have the agreement of the client. Sometimes if you do a consultancy project, the client or the product is, the client does not want it to make it public, so in those cases this cannot work. But in most of the cases, the client is more than happy that you use the results to, because this is also visibility for them. And one particularity of this type of research is that it's much more practical and policy oriented because it derives directly from the results that you have already elaborated from the consultancy process. And also, we have some research coming from secondments, research interns and fellows. Secondment, one example would be Santi Gorostiza, who I think he was who is part of this project.
We're very good at getting the people outside and the name of the people from outside. Just a warm welcome, please.
Wonderful. I was just mentioning you as an example. Secondly, he is in the Coimbra University, and he decided to spend a few months in end working with Miguel on I don't know exactly on what. Then also quite often we have research interns, people from either undergraduate or from master courses, spending a few months doing specific bits of research that are of common interest. And then we have also fellows, which is a figure we created to engage and to provide affiliation to former end workers and to scientists which we have particularly good relation. And then another question that we do is just try to support the personal research of the consultants doing their own research as part of their PhDs, for example. And these are just two examples of papers of people working at end that were done during their PhD studies. But also this contributes to create a profile, and then it's useful to have more access to research projects and so on. And then we also see some other forms of cooperation between consultancies and universities. One is involving universities in competitive calls for tenders, for example, from the European Commission or from national authorities. Calls that are normal, or proposals which are normally led by consultancies. One example is a recent proposal we presented to the Joint Research Center in Sevilla, the Institute for Prospective Technological Studies, in which we involved partners from the university. Similarly to proposals, research proposals in which universities try to involve consultancies, this would be the other way around. Consultancies leading a proposal, maybe not so research oriented, which involve universities as part of the team. Second option is involving scientists as part of scientific advisory committees. One recent example of this, for example, a report we just appeared last week. This was a report we did for Fundación Biodiversidad, which is dependent on the Ministry of Environment here in Spain. In this case, Esteban Corbera and Eric Gómez, which are both lecturers here at the Autonomous University of Barcelona, we involved them as a scientific committee. And this contributed, I don't know how much, but this somehow contributed to us being able to, in first place, to win this tender, and in second place, to, of course, to improve the product with knowledge about the state of the art of payment for environmental services and other economic instruments. And another option is that the same, or the contrary as before, as universities can subcontract consultancies, and consultancies can also subcontract universities, and we've also done this in some occasions. This is also a paper which appeared, or a report which appeared maybe 1 year ago, which is the economic balance of door-to-door and road containers waste collection for local authorities, based on the information of Catalonia. In this case, it was useful to have a university on board because this could give more prestige to the report and more objectivity. And in this case, we enrolled Jordi Roca not from the Autonomous University, but from the University of Barcelona. There's a mistake here, and he did. Together with us, the coordination or the direction of this report is a sort of different cooperation. Okay, and then some thoughts on the options for public administrations to support and to contribute to research. First of all, one obvious thing they can do, and they actually do, is to provide funding. This is particularly crucial for basic research and for research related to public goods. In this case, it's very difficult to get funding from private sources. In other cases, it's easier if it's more applied research or research which is easier to capitalize in the market, then it's easier to get funding from the private sector. But from these cases, providing public funding is basic to stimulate this sort of research. A second option is, or second task, is setting research priorities. This is clearly done, for example, by the European Commission at the European level in defining the priorities of the H2020 program, for example. Third option would be to contract the evaluation of specific policies. And I will give some examples here as well of recent work we've done that would fit in this area. This was, for example, a project that was commissioned by us, by a municipality who had some problems and understanding why there were so many impurities in their separate waste collection, or bio-waste in particular. And this was funded by the regional waste authority here in Catalonia. And what we did was to analyze a series of quarterly analyses that they do on all municipalities in Catalonia, on presence of impurities in the separate waste collection. And from that, once the project was finalized, we asked permission to them to elaborate a little bit more on the results and publish a research paper in one of the top waste management journals, which tries to model statistically which are the factors that explain this presence of impurities. But this derives from one administration, one public administration, trying to assess the results of one policy. And two more examples here are, for example, this study we did on the effectiveness of the landfill and waste incineration taxes in Catalonia, which is a very successful case study of this sort of taxes. Or this other one in Spanish, which evaluates the effect that came as a consequence of the reform of the vehicle registration tax in Spain, which was modified in 2008 and then of course, some incentives appeared, and this had some consequences. So we lowered an econometric model to explain the try to explain which have been these effects.
I need to complete that with another example that also I think it's relevant for working on political ecology, is that not always you succeed to use this sort of resources that comes from other projects, etc., to get some public some publications as a research issues. For example, remember once that we were asked to do a research on was the use of sustainability indicators in Agenda 21 schemes in Catalonia, who were benefited from the use, who they used it, etc. Because they thought that it would be useful for them, these sort of studies, to push further the use of these indicators. But the result was basically that they have been spending the money without any sort of use in the last 10 years. And of course, at that point, we say, oh, that's interesting research point. We can maybe try to use it somewhere else. And then, of course, we found it that we were not allowed to use it. So that's, I mean, it's not always easy to move once you find some results that they do not feel so comfortable to use it in the at the research arena. But this is something that all of us that were involved on political ecology, we have to be ready if we go for this. Processes. If the results more or less fits well with the discourse, they will support it. Otherwise, they will push some problems.
Because in the contract that you signed said that you cannot use the data that you.
Basically, it's always like that.
Yeah.
And even if you don't have a contract, formal contract with this, where it's stated, I mean, if you are working, for example, for a regional government and you don't fulfill this obligation, you are basically out. You will never be contracted, but you will have a very bad reputation in the other institution. So it is, even if it's not written, at least in this very small country, Catalonia, that we all know each other, it's something that you have to respect. If you have a contract, at least you have to ask them.
Okay. Yeah,
can I can use it? Or I can.
But in this case, you asked them, they said no.
Okay, another important role that the administration can play is just to provide the arena to develop some innovative experiences. And from these cases, from these innovative experiences, case studies can be derived, and it's quite common and there is a tradition to publish best practices as research papers. And we have really quite high number of examples of this. I just want to mention a couple of them. But in the first case, the City Council of Barcelona commissioned us a quite nice study on how on to check whether the anti-advertising stickers that people can put in their the door of their house, in their mailbox, whether these speakers were of any use or not. So we for a period of 3 or 4 months, we were monitoring, I think, 100 homes, asking people to separate the advertising they were receiving, and then we waited this advertising. So in this case, and then we balance this. And so in this case, this is more a case of not so much as a best practice, but as a case of evaluation of a specific policy. And this other case, it was another example of project financed by the Catalan Waste Authority that wanted to deal with a quite significant problem in relation to waste management, which is what to do with disposal of nappies. There is nothing to do with them at present. You cannot recycle them. You cannot, if you burn them, you have problems, of course, and if you landfill as well. So we did a project together with the Autonomous University of Barcelona, with the chemical engineering department, on what to do with these products. And we set, we conducted a lab analysis and then an analysis also at industrial scale in a composting plant. So this was thanks to a region or a local authority which was very interested in trying to find a solution to this problem. And then we have, for example, many case studies derived from municipalities which have implemented, for example, door-to-door collection schemes or pay-as-you-throw schemes, which were pioneer in Spain a few years ago. So there is quite a lot of interest in from other municipalities to have information on these case studies. So it's relatively easy to publish them and
For example, this research on DPERS was interesting to mention, for example, that it can look like a very technical issue, but it is not. In fact, for example, once we publish, I don't remember how long does it takes, but how long did it take? But I remember that the main producers of DPERS came to us challenging the results. They say, hey, you are producing this, you are publishing it, this is, has to do waste management, but it's also dealing with our interests, so it's quite often you get responses through the research and through the publication of these sort of issues that really makes you realize that after the publication of the technical issues, you have to like do a follow-up process. That for a consultancy, it's not always easy, but it's really important if you want to finally finish with some changes in public policies. Mm-hmm. Because of course, they also went to the public administration and said, hey, this is easy. That's not proper because you have to consider blah, 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 blah. That's your research cannot be finished just when you publish. That's my only main issue, that you have to think about that in some cases it may require some more time to work on political terms.
Mm. Yeah, one final option I just wanted to mention in relation to one final option for public administrations is to get involved as partners in the research projects. This is not so common and not so easy, but there are some examples of this, that, for example, a municipality or region, which becomes part of a consortium in a research proposal, because they provide the arena, the technical knowledge of the concrete geographical area, and so on. So this is also a final option for them. Okay, and I'm about to finish. Just a couple of final thoughts. I think that, well, research in the consultancy area and in the academia has some significant differences, both in terms of resources available and maybe the practical and sometimes not so practical orientation of the research, but also there are quite a lot of similarities, particularly in the cases where we go hand by hand with universities in presenting research proposals. Although in general research is not the main purpose of most consultancy projects, and that's clear, and there are a huge number of consultancies that conduct exactly zero research. But several reasons, in my opinion, suggest that it's interesting to strengthen the collaboration between the academia and the consultancy world for several reasons. One is that there is a growing interest from public administrations, and this is particularly clear at the European level, from growing interest from the European Commission to include different types of organizations in their research projects. Then, because consultancies can provide hands-on, very practical knowledge in the projects, which sometimes it's more difficult to this type of knowledge to access from the universities. And one final reason is that including consultancies in the research projects also makes more credible for the funders. That this will have a real impact on the final implementation of policies, and also probably also a high impact in terms of dissemination, which is somewhat linked to the issue I mentioned just before. So for these several reasons, I think that these are all points to strengthen this sort of collaboration. So I very much look forward to materialize this also with you. That's all from my side. Thank you.
About the examples of the we are going to take three questions and then we will. I was just thinking of the examples that you gave us of the papers that you worked on and influence policy making. And I was thinking at the very beginning of our course, we were given a series of lectures on research design. And we were explained that political ecology is a critical science, not a technical one, and therefore it aims not to solve practical problems, but to but to solve or to advance understanding of conceptual problems, which obviously have political implications, and most of us would start probably from political concerns. But in our research, we don't address these kind of practical problems. You know, a research of the type of research that we do wouldn't ask how do we improve crops productivity. It would ask how has the improvement of crop productivity affected the specimen community. You know? So how do we, starting from this premise, interface with policy making?
Rather different kind of question. How do your university partners deal with potential conflict of interest? So one, or that's not a term, maybe there's maybe another European term for this. So if I'm receiving a contract from a client as a university faculty, the biggest concern that you would have if you were one of my colleagues is that I would use my position as a faculty member governing the university to provide improved access, for example, to contracting for that client over time. That, in other words, that there's an opportunity for quid pro quo. That is where you're paying me for research, but what I'm delivering actually is not just the research, right, but something else. And it's a very serious problem in the US with many folks working very successfully on good consultancy work, is always that ever-present hazard about how the university is governed. I don't know if this comes up ever in your work, or if your partners are considering.
This time we have a couple of questions. The first one is, can you tell us a case where you think your work has influenced the making of some policy or some policy, and what sort of reflections would you have as regards what sort of work influences policy, what type of work, or what sort of engagement with research or consultancy can influence policy? And the second one, you have both, this is for both of you, because you have both passed from academia to consultancy, a specific type of consultancy, a little bit broader, obviously, than traditional consultancy. So just wondering, what was your experience of these passage, you know, from academia to consultancy, whether you had some expectations when you did it, whether you had some anxieties you had before as well, and whether they had materialized. Because I think it's relevant also for some of the fellows who are thinking, well, can I do something different than academia? So.
Well, not easy questions. Well, in relation to the, I'm not sure if I will provide the right answer for your question, but yeah, of course, there are some disciplines which are seem more problem-oriented than others, but and maybe political ecology is not the most problem-oriented one. But however, in my opinion, I mean, if the aim is to change reality somehow, you always can find your approach to have an incident in real practical policies. Maybe Miguel can add something else, but from my opinion, both in the case of Gabriel Weber and Irmak, who are part of this project, the research was quite oriented to real policies. It fit well within our work, and from that research they derived publications which were nice in terms of research products, but also we aim to have some practical incidents on the real world. So it, of course, the discipline which you are can facilitate more or less the orientation of how you address specific problems, but at the end is also how is your personal approach within that discipline. I'm not sure if I addressed properly your question, but that's my answer.
In relation, can I go to for example, just two examples. And for example, as a consultancy, we have been providing support to the Observatory, the DeadWatch Observatory, which is an NGO which is more or less well known around here. And we have worked also to support them in the, let's say, creation or analysis of illegitimate debt. What does it mean, illegitimate debt in this state? That was provided also for us, which is much more on the creation and development or some concepts. But you also can work, for example, you have plenty of tools, you have been training for that also, to get an analysis of power analysis between the different actors. This is something that can also be provided as a consultancy to the either public administrations, NGOs, and this has been already the case. So I do think that both in terms of creating concepts, frameworks, etc., or either using tools which are very much linked with different power relations and interest actors which are more in sociological perspective, I think these are something that we have done in the past, so that's not working with some other examples afterwards. Was for example this concept of, or even here, for example, the concept of ecological debt, which is very well known for all of you. We did work for 5-6 years in the Observatory of Delta to put it in the society as a concept. So that's not so much problematic in practical terms.
Okay. In relation to the question of conflict interest, I'm afraid I'm not able to provide an answer because I have not come across any of the problems. Maybe you want to.
I only want to put one example in the University of Autonomous Vienna, also from the veterinarian department, which is another one, which of course they are very linked with industrial. Michigan University, I know they have had some trouble on this issue, which is, basically all the money comes from the industry, so they are somehow have some incentives to provide them with some outputs, which are also at the same time providing them some interest. And my main answer to this is that, at least at the extent that I know, there are not enough systems implemented in the Autonomous University right now to solve this. Because I see it in practical terms. My answer is much to be done here in the universities.
Mm. Yeah, of course, but sometimes we working as consultants, we also come across people in the administration or somewhere else that somewhat want to dictate the conclusions of your product, but then, well, we are rather small, not so much economically depending from any actor.
Diversity of
so this may be a good point to try to be have enough diversification in the funds, but at the end maybe you need also some code or conduct or something like that.
There's some ethical questions, but yes. There's just also some process things.
as an institute director, I have to interview all of the faculty who work for me, who have taken outside money, and ask them face to face that they've not used their position to alter a contract or bring business. And this doesn't happen very much. I mean, it's not a serious problem, but if you don't have a system, you're inviting a problem.
Makes sense because we don't have it.
Well, in relation to your questions, examples of cases in which we've had an influence, yeah, I have some examples formally. One could be all the three of them relate to, no, two of them relate to waste management and one to environmental taxation. For example, we introduced in Spain the concept of pay as you throw. There were no examples of pay as you throw. Pay as you throw means waste charges at local level, which you pay according to the actual amount of waste you generate as a family or as a commercial activity. Okay? This is very common in the US and in Central Europe, but there were no experiences in Spain at all. So we introduced the first one in 2003 and a few more later, and now it's not mainstream still. But it's in all waste programs in Spain, I would say.
And this through a study or?
Through pilots, basically. Trying to find municipalities who could potentially be interested in this, finding resources from the regional authorities, for example, to finance these pilots, which makes sense to finance because they assume the risks and so on. This could be one example. One other example would be the idea of fee-based systems. This is an economic instrument we not invented but adapted to the waste management, which means that in case of associations of municipalities which share waste management systems, it is critical how they distribute the costs of these waste management systems among themselves. It can be done in a way which fosters waste prevention, recycling, and so on, and it can be in another way which doesn't. So we developed conceptually one economic instrument, and now it's starting to be applied by some of these local authorities. And there were no presence in them. So this could be two examples.
One social innovation perspective, it can be also, for example, we did run the coordination of on fisheries issues around 30 NGOs, small scale fishermen NGOs, but also small scale fishermen producers, and also some research groups. So I mean, in this world of getting different people from different backgrounds and different knowledge and perspectives, I do think it's also a thing that can be properly done in consultancies if we have what we have heard this morning, trust between us and yourself. So, but at the same time, sometimes it's an advantage in the sense of saying that you can be perceived more, let's say, like a player that can be accepted by different stakeholders. Sometimes it can be a barrier, but sometimes it can be an advantage. For example, at the start it was very difficult to work well between NGOs and fisheries, fishermen. They just don't want to, even if they have in a political terms, very much, it makes sense, full sense. But if you have these other actors in between, as a consultancy, for example, then they can approach a little bit more, and if they have trust, then you can construct this
Mm-hmm. And in relation to your second question on the pass from the academia to the consultancy, well, in our case, we basically started this from nothing. So we created our own company, and we created with our best will and knowledge, and trying to orientate it so it could fit research in it. Probably this wouldn't be this is not the easiest way, and not, certainly not the, the quickest. Maybe another option would be to try to get involved, try to take advantage of one opportunity through one specific project. For example, one project such as Entitle, no? Which allows someone to, and who is working in the academia, to get involved in a consultancy through a specific project, and during the course of this project, you can be active preparing additional proposals and so on, so you can prepare the ground to continue in the future. That could be not easier because there are not so many opportunities, but maybe it's a way to do this pass from the academia to the consultancy. If you want to do consultancy with a certain research perspective, there are many other opportunities in the consultancy which are not linked at all with research.
My view on that is that from the start we have very clear that we want to do, continue doing research. I mean, it was not like say, hey, I'm bye-bye from the academia, I want to do research. No, we want to. But we also have very clear that we want to do some applied research. I mean, we want to be biased, and I like it very much. I like more theoretical research, and that's good for me, but I mean, clearly this is not the, let's say, the best way to do it if you want to go for consultancy. So we have these 2 years. From my own perspective, the main difficulties, this is not only from my experience, but also from people that have been involved in these sort of processes, is that coming from the university, you tend to think research as a long time period. 4 years, I'm going to, impossible, 6 years. 6 years and I will finish my research. Okay, that's good. That's impossible. That's a mental barrier, okay, no? And it's also very linked with the fact of we are researchers, we want to go in depth to the issues before moving one hair to any this way. Okay. Then the next stop is, okay, you have 6 months. Take it or leave it. That's it. And that's very difficult. For those that are trained to do like this long perspective. So that to me these are the more to live with these realities which are there, and I don't know how to avoid it. It's a more tricky issue. So just be prepared. If you jump into these issues, that will be part of your reality. In some cases you are very lucky, as ourselves in this case, our entire project, we have a long time for you, know, that's lovely. But it's not the case in many other cases, so and I think it would be impossible to avoid. So these to me are the two main issues. The good part, and I find it very interesting, is the fact that you cannot be just seated in your chair in front of your computer and losing reality from your desk. If you do it, in a year you'll be out. Yeah, that's how things work in our case. No, you have to talk with many people. You have to go to municipalities, to local, to NGOs, to whoever. But in universities, at least in many cases, you have, you all know that, you have research, people who is funded by research, but you also have people who is funded just by, because it's public administration, and they think that it's interesting to have someone to pay for the research, so they can sit there and not move, and that won't change too much. This is absolutely out of scope in our cases. So everybody that is there has to move and be able to maintain a sort of link with the current reality, even if you want to change it. But you cannot skip the current reality. That's impossible. That's I think it's challenging, but I find it also interesting. Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah. So, in one of the, I have some friends who have gone also into consultancy from my critical, what we would call political ecology, though but one of the challenges that I've seen and that they have confided is consistent with your values, because there are a few actors that you could consult with and that are in parallel with the way that we think as critical scholars or activists or researchers. And so they end up doing more than half of their work pro bono with activists and organizations and communities who are the ones that oftentimes need this kind of grassroots consultancy but don't have the money to pay it. And then they do some consultancy also with big environmental NGOs, with local governments. And so have you had this experience of working also for grassroots organizations, for movements, and how have you balanced this, and how have you dealt with this issue of body consistency?
Yeah, well, I don't know much about how consultancies work. I mean, I've read some reports, and it always was a question to me, and maybe it's a bit of an abstract one, but how do you deal with the issue of validity of what you write? And I'm not talking about articles of a researcher that might spend 6 months and publish an article, but from people that are in the organization, you know, for a long time, and they write reports and they give their kind of assessment of a situation. So how do you, you know, how do you deal with validity, and how do you deal with uncertainty? Because especially if you work in a short periods of time, and I mean, in almost all cases, exactly because you deal with short times, you will not be sure that what you're saying is the whole picture, or even, you know, the right or versus wrong and so on. But what is the language? I mean, that's my problem with consultancies, that they write in a way as if this is the
truth or whatever.
This is it, yeah. And yeah, how do you deal with it? But the problem is, if you don't write that way, I think you you won't be taken seriously, right?
I have two experiences with consultants, with colleagues of mine that have done in related to the Amazon in Brazil. And it's really complex. I mean, the first two, they happened in the beginning of when Lula arrives to the government. And then we have all this chaos going on in the Amazon, deforestation for 27,000 square kilometers per year. I mean, we have to do something, you know. And then we have a good government, a good minister, and then a great group of researchers, they do a huge consultants program, which is called the Plan Against Deforestation. And it's really well done research, it's a great reference. The problem is some of the measures were taken, and we controlled quite well deforestation. And some of the same members of this group, they did another consult. It was against land grab and very violent conflicts in the Amazon. And I read and I used and I quote that. It's an amazing research. It's much better than most of the papers that I've read about conflict, etc. Because this is people who really knows what they're talking about. And this consultancy was done to the Minister of Justice. Then comes one big problem of some of these cases, which is frustration. I mean, we know what's happening. Here it is. You just need to take these measures. And then the minister gets that and thanks a lot. That's it. You know? But and one more challenging problem that's really a question, like questioning the use of science, is related to the to big projects, let's say development projects. And then we have the dance. And it's not an easy thing to say, like I'm not doing it. Like related to consulting, not we as consultants, but consulting indigenous people who are going to be affected. And they need, let's say, the companies need people to make this mediation. And in some cases, they try to hire the anthropologists who works with them. And that's the ones who the indigenous group trust. And I know some very serious anthropologists who think like, either I go there and try to do the best because I know them, they trust me, and I want to defend them, or relief for a company. Last September, the Society of Archaeologists, they issue a public letter against any consultants to illegal projects. What I mean, if the project has some points against the constitution, which is all the dams, so the Society of Archaeologists very politicized, they politicized that, let's say, politicized this issue because anthropologists, the Anthropological Association in Brazil has no one, has not a public opinion about it, let's say official one, but archaeologists, they are rejecting, I mean, the ones who take it, they are starting to have problems with the rest of the society. But it's a very hard issue. I mean, there is some consultants that it's not like, let's say, where they are coming to ICTA to see how can we improve that. There's some things that we're really engaged in that, and that's the chance to work. And it's a really hard thing to, it's not an easy question whether you are accepting or just leave for the others and you take your side and say, okay, have nothing to do with that. I think it's a very important thing for us to think on how we position ourselves in that.
One more, and then we go.
Oh, I don't know if maybe you explained something like at the beginning, sorry that I missed it. But precisely from what you were saying now, Michele, I was thinking that we tend, or some of us maybe we tend to conceive research sometimes as something very invasive of our own time, our private time sometimes. So I was wondering how in a company, in a consultancy company in the end, if you could explain a bit, could you design the time that you link to the activities related to publications, that is depending on the project that you have, do you plan when you have a project if you will be devoting time to research and therefore assign some hours to this? Or, I mean, how do you try to prevent the possibility that this becomes an extra task for the worker? What if the worker says, I'm not interested in research, I don't want to do that?
Okay, I'll rapidly go through the different questions. In relation to the challenge of being consistent with your own values, I just wanted to mention that. Well, again, you can do this if you're not so much dependent on one specific sort of funding. But I would say that it's not only a matter that the client has to choose you, but you also have to choose the client. I mean, if you want to avoid value conflicts, maybe the best thing you can do to start with is to avoid working with someone you can probably think that you will have this sort of problems. And I think this is explicitly or not what we try to do in most of the time.
Just an example, there are a couple of them.
Yeah. For example, now we a few weeks ago we received a call from the. I mean, in the past we did a couple of reports for Greenpeace on the costs of waste incineration and also on the overcapacity of waste incineration in Spain and in Europe. And a few weeks ago, quite surprisingly, we received a call from the group of waste incinerators in Spain, asking us to, if we wanted to do a project on the positive impact of waste incineration in terms of labor, in terms of number of workplaces that they create. So, I mean, I was quite surprised that they contacted us because, I mean, we've been clearly positioned against waste incineration, but well, we prefer to decline because I mean, it was not clear that we could express our opinion freely. So this is the example Miguel was mentioning. And
it's not surprised, it's a good idea. They say these guys are against it. If we get them to say that we create
yes.
You know, lots of positions, then we're there.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to make clear your ideas and your positions. It's so easy to accept this sort of thing.
I prefer not to ask how much they were preparing to.
Please let us know that I'm sending. No, don't send me more.
Okay, in relation to your question on the how we deal with validity and uncertainty, it's not an easy question, and I'm not sure if I have a right answer. But well, I think, in my opinion, in quite a number of cases, what the client wants is your honest, informed, and objective opinion based on your experience. That's the difference, maybe, between consultancy and experience based on your past work, your past practical projects, and so on. So, I mean, sometimes the client is not so much interested in a literature review, a very detailed number of sources, and so on. Although, my answer would be that in our case, we try to be quite rigorous in terms of expliciting all the references we've used, and particularly expliciting all the hypotheses we have been used, we are using to derive the results. So sometimes it's clear that we have to do some assumptions which maybe are not so well fundamented, but clearly the client wants clear, concrete, precise answer for his or her problem. So we have to provide that. In some cases, we have to choose some hypotheses, sometimes more robust, sometimes less. But what we try to do, and that maybe is a difference from consultancies, is to provide all the explicit, all the hypotheses we are using.
And one point on this, is that, at least from experience on some cases, specific cases, it's not such a problem to say or to put in a record, more research needs to be done, because we don't know that. But if Max says that, we know that. But the point is that if the first point is more research needs to be done, you are fine. Mm-hmm. Okay, basically, which is something that can be somehow allowed in the university. Okay. Final outcome of my project, more research needs to be done. And if I see this, I just squat the report. Okay. That's what happens. It's not acceptable for a consultancy. But it can be said, okay? If it's the first line, okay, bad luck, that's not a problem. That's a limit ask for researchers. But this is not in current with the fact of, okay, taking into consideration these hypotheses, then we suggest this. Mm-hmm. And then you can add, of course, and our research needs to be done mainly on these points that we think that are important and can change results, blah, blah, blah. So we are talking more about transparency here than anything else. Mm-hmm. And it can be accepted, but of course, you have to provide something as an outcome also. It's more or less the same as saying, okay, I'm doing a PhD, I've been working for 5 years, now I'm going to pressure. I've been working for 4 years now, and then now I have finished my project, and I don't have a PhD, and I will do it in 8 years. Is it acceptable? No. You have to have some papers, or you have to do something. That's how it works at university. I mean, just my point is that it's not acceptable anymore in the university too. I mean, just these times, if you don't like it.
Well, in relation to your considerations, I think it was more that was not a specific question, but yeah, we also find sometimes across this issue of frustration. When you do some report, you put a lot of effort on this, and maybe the outcomes are not so satisfactory for the public administration who commissioned the results, the report, and then the reporting ends up not being published, not being publicized. That's frustrating, but this is how these things happen sometimes. And in relation to the question by Santi on how we allocate time, I mean, well, we, on the one hand, we have based on the research program I mentioned, we have an overall allocation of time for the whole year. Content. But then, based on the progress of the different projects, we decide on a case-by-case basis. We have to consider that this relates a bit with the comment Miquel did before. we have to think that in our case we go in the range of 20 projects per year, more or less, with an average of 6-8 months duration each. So at the beginning of the year, we don't know which project we'll be doing 5 months ahead. So it's only on a case by case that we can decide whether some results are going to be, are going to be interesting enough to be published and so on. So it's, something we decide day by day. Framed on this overall allocation of the early hours. But for example, one example the same week, we finished a report for the Catalan Waste Agency 2 years ago, more or less. Now we have the permission of them to publish the, to use the results. We have a 150 pages report, for example, and we want to produce a paper of 10 pages with no additional research, only. And we have 30 hours to do that. Okay? and we'll do it, certainly. Maybe this will get some refinement when we receive some comments from the reviewers and so on. But the goal is, of course, the research is already done, and maybe we put 300 or 400 hours by then. But now we have the research, 550 pages in Catalan, and we want 10, 15 pages in English. That is really done in 30 hours. If it's 35, no worries, but it cannot be 50.
Thanks a lot,
Jesse. Did our PhD here in the Autonomous University of Barcelona under the supervision of Martin Ravier, so we are familiar with the discipline of ecological economics, and although this discipline is still not very present in the area of consultancy, we try to do quite a lot of work on this. Then I'm coordinating these two areas, and then Miquel Ortega is coordinating these other two, environmental justice and political ecology, and also fishing policies. So our work is mainly for public administrations, from the local to the European level, but also occasionally, but increasingly, we are also working for other actors such as NGOs, universities, or even trade unions or political parties. Very rarely we work for companies, in most cases, either public administrations or institutions with a public interest. Okay, then starting with the issue of research, in the area of consultancy, it's not so common to find people also doing research. Often our colleagues feel quite surprised about Mons, along with Italia Editorial, and which Gian Martinez is not only the founder, but also still continues to coordinate the journal. It's published in Spanish and distributed in Spain and Latin America. And every issue focuses in one specific topic, this one on cities, for example.
And you're very welcome to contribute to UN, by the way.
Miquel Ortega is the main brain. Coordinating and making this happen along with Tiumac and some others. Okay. How is that the consultancy can contribute, can do research, can contribute doing research? First of all, it can be in the framework of specific research projects. In this case, I will give now some examples. In this case, it is more like acting like a private research center. Okay. First of all, one first option could be getting involved in consortia, taking part in competitive calls for proposals. You normally start by thanking the organizers to invite you here. I'm not so sure if in this case I have to thank them, because it's been a bit tough for me to prepare this presentation. I'm not used to talk about these issues. I'm more on the waste management, environmental taxation, and other aspects. But they, since we in the consultancy are quite active, so I will try to explain you now. In the area of research, they asked me to develop a bit the idea on how consultancies can be also actors in the research area, how can be established links with the academia and the university, and also which is the role or the possible role of public administrations in supporting research, both in consultancies and in the academia. So these are basic goals of my presentation. I will start by presenting a little bit who we are. Probably you know already a bit since we are part of the entitled project and you know some of our colleagues. I will develop then what are the types of research that can be done in a consultancy, us being active in the area of research. But this has been like that in our case since we started. And I will now develop this a little bit, but just wanted to inform you that we recently approved or elaborated a research plan for the next years, just to try to have our own orientation and define a little bit the areas, main areas, priorities, and also resources to be allocated in the following years to this research. I include the link here, although it's only in Spanish and Catalan now, but it's also in English. And this was an effort to organize, as I said, a little bit the priorities and also the resources, which are particularly scarce in our case, because of our size and because it's difficult to find sources to finance all these research projects. I also wanted to mention these two all means of publication. This is a collection of books, only one issue so far, but there will be more coming along. And then this journal, which we edit every 6. From my presentation, I will be using examples I know from our own work to exemplify this. And also, as I said, which are the options for public administration to also conduct, support, orientate this research. And then I will very briefly conclude with some general opinions on this. My idea is to talk about 30 minutes or so, and then we can start a debate. So, ENT is a rather small consultancy and research center. We are 11 people at the moment. And we have two different legal forms, a company and a foundation. And our mission, generally speaking, is contributing towards a social, environmental, and economic sustainable society by starting and implementing innovative approaches in the fields of environmental policies. We are located in Villanueva del Sur, which is around 40 kilometers in the south of Barcelona. And our main working areas are, as I said, waste management, particularly urban waste management, ecological and environmental economics. Three of the funders of this project